Okay, so we will discuss about genital tuberculosis today. This is a very, very important topic, especially in countries like India. Tuberculosis remains a major public health problem globally, with 10 million persons developing active tuberculosis each year. So it is a global data which is given, 10 million persons having active TB each year with 1.33 million deaths. So ultimately, we all know this, all these infectious diseases are taking the lead nowadays, isn't it? So 1.33 million deaths are occurring, and more than one fourth of this global incidence is with our country, India. Now, the most common presentation of tuberculosis in India is pulmonary tuberculosis. So pulmonary tuberculosis is the most common. And the most, besides this pulmonary, when tuberculosis occurs in any other organs, such as it may be the bones, it can be genitourinary, it can be joints, wherever it occurs, it is called as extrapulmonary tuberculosis. That is also increasing, and the incidence is about 15 to 20% of all tuberculosis. So amongst all tuberculosis, 15 to 20% is extrapulmonary, rests on pulmonary. Now, amongst this extrapulmonary, 9% is contributed by the genital tract tuberculosis only. This data has been quoted as 9%, but the actual incidence of female genital tract tuberculosis is not known due to underreporting of cases. Many of the cases are not reported, mainly because of many are asymptomatic. There may be bad symptomatology and lack of reliable diagnostics with high sensitivity. So you just have to remember that female genital tract tuberculosis contributes a lot to the medical problems, to the medical burden of our country especially. And as we deal with infertility patients, it is still that 5 to 10% of the patients with infertility are suffering from tuberculosis. First case of genital tuberculosis was reported in 1744, when the autopsy of a young woman died of tuberculosis peritonitis was done, and it was diagnosed to be a case of genital tuberculosis. Now, the pathogenesis. It is caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and rarely, so each student logs in when we have to. So, it is caused by Mycobacterium tuberculosis in most of the cases. Okay, around 90 to 95% of the cases. 5 to 10% it could be Mycobacterium bovis or some atypical mycobacteria. Now, this genital tract tuberculosis, how do the genital organs get infected? It is almost always secondary to tuberculosis of other organs, such as the lungs, the lymph nodes, the urinary tract, which is very adjacent, the bones or the joints. So, from where does, how does tuberculosis spread from these organs to the lungs? It could be by hematogenous route also. It could be by lymphatics or directly from the bowels, which are very nearby. Then mesenteric nodes or the peritoneum. So it can be a direct spread also. It can be hematogenous spread, it can be lymphatic spread, it can be direct spread. Now, some have quoted that the reason could also be ascending infection. So it is very much controversial, but it may be possible in vulval, vaginal or cervical lesions, that the local lesions there could be by sexual transmission from male partner with urogenital tuberculosis. So we know the most important organism responsible, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, and the most important mode of spread to the genital organs. Now, which organs are mainly involved? It is almost up to 100% of the cases. The first organ involved is the fallopian tube, and from the fallopian tube, it spreads to the other organs, like the uterus, especially the endometrium of the uterus, the ovaries, which are involved in 30% of the cases, endometrium in 60% of the cases. The cervix would be involved in 5 to 15% of the cases. Vulval and vaginal tuberculosis is rare, very rare in fact, it's 1% only. And the pelvic peritoneum will be involved in 40 to 50% of the cases. Now, what actually happens in fallopian tube involvement? Both the tubes, it is a bilateral involvement of the tubes. Initially, infection is in the submucosal layer of the ampulla. So it is in the submucosa, then it gradually spreads to the muscle layers. So when we think of the fallopian tubes, it is in the submucosa, then it spreads medially to involve the muscle layer. So it will destroy the muscle layer, it will cause fibrosis of the muscle layer. Some segmental thickening, destruction of the mucosa also. So ultimately, there will be segmental thickening of the fallopian tube. Then there is appearance of tobacco pouch appearance. What actually happens is that here the mucosa is also destroyed. Ultimately, the tube will appear swollen and congested, but the abdominal ostia, the fimbrial end, will remain open. So it will appear as a tobacco pouch. But if the fimbrial end become closed because of adhesions and all, what happens is that some this pus-like material gets remains pent up in the tube, resulting in pyosulfase. So these are the changes which occur in the fallopian tube due to the infection. There could be fibrosis, there could be segmental thickening, there could be tobacco pouch appearance. The isthmic region, nodularities in the isthmic region, so it's known as salpingitis. Salpings, this the word salpings is related to fallopian tube. So salpingitis isthmica nodosa. So why this salpingitis isthmica nodosa is not per se related to tuberculosis only. It can also occur in conditions like endometriosis. What happens is that here the epithelium of the fallopian tube, this undergoes proliferation within the hypertrophic muscle layer. So within the muscle layer, there will be proliferation of the epithelial layer. So this will cause some swelling, nodular swelling in the tube. Otherwise, apparently from outside, the tube will appear normal. So that portion, the isthmic region of the tube, gets affected. That is called a self-injected. In the isthmic region. Now this is when it spreads medially. The infection may spread outward also towards the peritoneal cavity with exudation. So initial phase it is exudative. It will cause, there will be pus discharge from the fimbrial end, and ultimately it will cause, in the later part, it will cause adhesion with the adjacent organs like the ovary, the peritoneum, the bowel sometimes also get involved, and there is a tubo-ovarian mass formed. So this is what happens to the fallopian tube. Now endometrium. Endometrium is affected in 60% of the cases. This may be from the tubes, it may be because of the vasculatures or throat. Now where do the tuberculosis lie? We know that there are three layers of the endometrium. The basal layer is the one which is not shed during menses. So what happens? The tubercles usually stay in the basal layer, but just before menstruation, they climb up to the upper layers also. So during each menses, what happens? After the other layers are shed, reinfection occurs from the basal layer again. So the layers are affected. So the basal layer bears all the tubercles. Now with repeated infections, what occur? They may occur endometrial ulceration. And ulceration, when occurs, the anterior and the posterior layer of the endometrium may fuse together. There could be adhesions between them. And that condition is known as Escherman syndrome. Now you can just imagine when the endometrium, the anterior and the posterior walls are opposed together, what problems the patient can have. The most commonly, infertility. Okay. Prior to that, many patients may have decreased flow during menses because the functional endometrium is decreased, there is adhesion. There could be oligomenorrhea, there could be hypomenorrhea, there is decreased flow during menses, or there could be even amenorrhea also. Okay. Then there could be infertility, as I already said, or there could be abortions. Even if there is an implantation somewhere, it's aborted. So this is the anterior and posterior wall and the adhesions amongst this. This is a hysteroscopic view. That is, we are seeing through the cervix, okay? Through the vagina and cervix, we have put a scope inside to see the interior of the uterus. This is called hysteroscopy. The word hyster is related to the uterus. So we are seeing within the uterus to see the adhesions inside. Now the tubercles in the basal layer of the endometrium may also invade up to the myometrium sometimes. And in postmenopausal women, it can lead to even pyometra. Okay. Next, involvement of the ovaries can occur in 30% of the cases. It may be in the form of perioophoritis, that is around the ovaries infection, or oophoritis directly. So there could be surface tubercles, There could be adhesions of the ovaries, there could be thickening of the capsule, there may be casuating abscess in the substance of the ovary. You just have to remember that the fallopian tubes are involved in up to 100% of the cases. Okay, the most important, the first organ to be affected, and then it gradually spreads to the other organs. Then the endometrium, in 60% of the cases, the endometrium would be affected. Then the ovaries would be affected in 30%. The cervix will be affected in 5 to 15% of the cases, which is quite frequent. So in the cervix there could be ulcerative or bright nodular lesion and which may bleed on touch. So in such cases, when we see a nodule or an ulcer in the cervix that bleeds on touch, the first impression that comes is that it could be a case of carcinoma. And even on histopathology, histological examination also, if you take a biopsy, sometimes marked epithelial hyperplasia with atypia could be present. In those cases again, there may be an erroneous diagnosis of carcinoma. So repeat histopathological slight review and all can, because if it doesn't match with the clinical characteristics, the history, other history suggestive of tuberculosis could be present. So clinical suspicion is a must to come to a conclusion to the diagnosis. Now involvement of the vulva and vagina is very, very rare. It's like 1% of the cases, even lesser than one might be. It may be an ulcerative lesion in the vulva or vagina. It may be like a warty lesion in the vulva vagina, or sometimes sinuses discharging caseous material or pus. There could be non-healing ulcers, okay, the sinuses discharging pus-like thing in the vulva and vagina. Now tuberculous peritonitis, that is the tuberculosis affecting the pelvic peritoneum mainly, of course, in 40 to 50% of the cases. So it may be a wet type or a dry type. In wet type or exudative type, what you will see is that the peritoneal cavity, there will be ascites, the serous fluid will be there, and medially tubercle-like thing, some lesions will be there in the tubes or the ovaries, the pelvic peritoneum, sometimes in the bowel also, tubercles would be there. But this is an early phase, exudative phase. In dry phase, what happens in the dry type? Post exudation, what happens, there was adhesions of the various pelvic organs. Sometimes it may be a frozen pelvis. Nothing would be visible when you put a scope in. So everything becomes adhered. This is in the dry or adhesive type. This is also known as the plastic type. Now, what are the factors which produce post TB? We all know anything that reduces immunity. The immunity of the patient can lead to tuberculosis. So in which group of people usually we find tuberculosis? It is usually related to poverty. Could be because of malnutrition and other factors, or overcrowding with improper ventilation. If one of them gets tuberculosis, it spreads to all the other family members or even the neighborhood. Inadequate access to healthcare. Then conditions which predispose one person to tuberculosis, like diabetes, where the immunity is decreased, diabetes mellitus, smoking, alcohol, drug abuse, or other factors. Then end-stage renal disease, patients on cancer treatment when the immunity is decreased, hemodialysis patients with HIV. Co-infection of tuberculosis with HIV is very, very important thing that we need to remember. So any patient when we are working up for tuberculosis, we have a clinical suspicion of tuberculosis, we have to work up simultaneously for HIV infection also. So tuberculosis, genital type tuberculosis, can affect any age group. The predominant group of 80% of the patients are of the reproductive age group, that is 20 to 40 years of age. Though it can occur also in postmenopausal women. So when we are extracting the history, we should always remember, and we are suspecting past history of clinical of past history, past personal history of tuberculosis is very important. Whether she already had history of tuberculosis of the lung, or the bones, anything, or the bowel, okay, box abdomen. So we have to take history of her history of tuberculosis in the past. We also need to take history, her family history of tuberculosis. Mostly these patients are asymptomatic, and some during some incidental, with newly incidentally diagnosed some features of tuberculosis during her investigation for other symptoms. Okay, there could be she may have presented with infertility, and then we had worked her up and found that in her hysterosalpingography there is some abnormality, in her laparoscopy there is some features suggestive of tuberculosis. Okay, so the patients may be asymptomatic, or ultrasound and for some other reason it comes. She may not have any symptoms related to genital tuberculosis, but somehow during workup of some other diseases or conditions, we may diagnose her to have suffering from genital tuberculosis. Now, there might be systemic symptoms or symptoms related to genital tuberculosis per se. Systemic symptoms, you all know, like any case of tuberculosis, there could be weight loss, there could be weakness, low grade fever, anorexia, night sweats. So low grade fever and night sweats are the ones which usually point towards tuberculosis as well as weight loss. Now, infertility, as already said, a majority of the patients of infertility, the 5 to 10% could be because of tuberculosis only. So while working up any infertile women, we have to keep tuberculosis in mind and we have to evaluate for tuberculosis. Menstrual abnormalities. See, in infertility, about 10% of the Indian infertile women have got tuberculosis. So how does genital tuberculosis cause infertility? It could be because of tubal blockade. It could be because of adhesions in the endometrial cavity like uterine synechia, or it could be because of associated ovulatory dysfunction. So all these things can lead to infertility. So what are the other problems that could be there in patients with genital tuberculosis? Besides infertility, there could be menstrual abnormalities, there could be chronic pelvic pain, there could be vaginal discharge. If there is a cervical lesion, vaginal lesion, there could be discharge. There could be abdominal swelling because of TO mass and all. There could be postcoital bleeding because of, again, lesions in the cervix, vagina, vulva. Okay, there could be some discharge and bleeding. Now, what kind of menstrual abnormalities these patients have? Which should, when patient present with such features, we should think it could be tuberculosis. Besides the general symptoms of tuberculosis, she may not have the systemic symptoms also. Those mentioned here, low grade fever, this could be completely absent in genital tuberculosis. Okay. When we study the endometrial tissue, infertility patient has come to us, and then when we are evaluating and we do an endometrial biopsy premenstrually, and we find the tuberculosis for DNA PCR becomes positive. So those patients may not have any other symptoms other than a PCR being positive. But some patients may have some abnormalities also. Some may be totally asymptomatic and some may have. We should not consider her as asymptomatic. She is having the complaint of infertility actually. Okay, otherwise no other symptoms would be present. Some may present with menstrual abnormalities like menorrhagia, menometrorrhagia, that is, menorrhagia is heavy menses, excessive flow during menses, isn't it? The patient may have menorrhagia, menometrorrhagia, heavy flow and irregularly occurring. Intermenstrual bleeding, in between menses there could be bleeding. Why this occurs? Because of ovarian involvement. As we have seen, the ovaries are involved in 30% of the cases. So because of the ovaries being involved, because of pelvic congestion or because of endometrial proliferation, all this can lead to increased flow during menses, menorrhagia, metrorrhagia, menometrorrhagia or intermenstrual bleeding. This is an early manifestation of the disease. Now, these patients, any case of menorrhagia, menometrorrhagia, what do? We try to treat them with, after preliminary evaluation, we treat them with hormones. But then these patients do not respond to hormones. So we should think this patient is not responding to hormone, it could be something else. Rarely, tuberculosis may be a cause of puberty menorrhagia, menorrhagia occurring in puberty, or even postmenopausal bleeding. In the later phases, what happens, the patient starts having amenorrhea or oligomenorrhea, which could be because of suppression of ovarian functions by the tubercular toxins. So ovarian function is affected. There could be endometrial destruction, uterine synechia formation, that is known as Escherman syndrome, where I have showed the picture where the anterior and the posterior wall of the uterus are adhered together. Or amenorrhea could also be because of general debility. Some chronic diseases can also cause amenorrhea. As such, this amenorrhea will be a late feature. So in menstrual abnormalities of the patient of tuberculosis, initial phase, there will be heavy flow. In the later phase, the flow will decrease, the duration will decrease, and sometimes the patient may go into amenorrhea directly. So when a patient comes with amenorrhea, we have to take history of preceding menorrhagia if present. Now, recurrent PID, you are treating a patient, when should you think that it could be tuberculosis? Recurrent PID, you are giving antibiotics but not getting cured. An adolescent, when it comes with ascites or pain abdomen, low grade fever, we should think that it could be because of tuberculosis again. Low grade fever with ascites and all. There is an important cause of ascites, as I told. Pelvic peritoneum involved in about 40 to 50% of the cases. Now, on examination again, as many cases may be asymptomatic on examination, in many cases there could be just no abnormal findings. However, on parabdomen examinations, the we feel may be present, which could be because of the matted intestines. Okay, there could be ascites, maybe palpable parabdomen. You may be getting the shifting dullness, okay, the fluid thrown along. Some mass may be palpable at times. Pelvic mass may also be palpable on parvaginal examination. Some adnexal mass may be palpable. Nodules may be felt through the POD. Okay, lesions in the local lesions may be present in the vulva, vagina, and the cervix. So these things may be present. When any mass, ascites, something is present, we should think of tuberculosis as a differential diagnosis. But in many cases, none of the features could findings could be present. No signs could be present. The diagnosis requires a high degree of clinical suspicion, a thorough clinical examination, and appropriate investigations. Now, what investigations are you going to do? As I already said, HIV is very important. So, in patients with tuberculosis, when you are investigating, you have to simultaneously do one HIV test and complete blood count. In complete blood count, hemoglobin may be decreased because in these patients, usually anemia is present in tuberculosis. Total count and ESR are usually raised. Monto is usually positive. It indicates the patient is already sensitive to the tuberculin protein. Now, quantiferin gold is another test which we do, which can be done in place of Monto. The advantage of this is that the report comes within 24 hours only. And then it is not affected by previous vaccination, BCG vaccination. Now here interferon is measured. When the interferon which is released by the T cells after they are exposed to the tuberculosis, that interferon level is measured. Now chest x-ray. We have to do chest x-ray to find if there is evidence of some healed or active pulmonary lesion. If she already had a healed lesion or she is yet having some pulmonary active lesions or not, that is why we need to do one chest x-ray. So this will guide to the fact whether she is having tuberculosis or not. Now for genital tuberculosis per se, we have to do some other investigations. Now as these patients usually come to us with some gynecological symptoms, so we usually advise, depending upon our clinical findings, we'll advise a pelvic ultrasound. And in this case, we may find localized ascites present. There could be laser strands with particulate matter in the fluid. There could be teomas, unilateral or bilateral. There could be hydrosalpings, as I already said, or biosalping, the fluid within the tubes, fallopian tubes are affected. If the fimbriland is blocked, there could be collection of fluid or pus within the tubes. So hydrosalpings could be present. Fluid could be present in the cul-de-sac or peritoneal cavity. That is, ascites could be present, minimal or even more. Then mesenteric lymphadenopathy may be present. The uterus may be small with atrophic endometrium or enlarged with gaseous pyometra. So these are the features which may be present in pelvic ultrasound. However, it may be absolutely normal also. Now, hysterosalpingography should not be done when we are suspecting tuberculosis. And in a proved case, it is contraindicated. However, as a part of infertility investigation, we advise the patients to be a hysterosalpingography. So during the process of investigating for infertility, some pictures may come up which may suggest that the patient might be suffering from tuberculosis. Now rigid non-peristaltic pipe-like tubes, the tubes will become rigid. There could be beaded appearance of the tube. There could be bilateral corneal block. There could be fluffiness of the tubal outline. There could be extravasation of dye. That is, the dye should be within the uterine cavity. It could pass through the myometrium and outside. Then tobacco pouch appearance is already explained. Then uterine cavity, there could be irregular outline, there could be honeycomb appearance or presence of uterine cyanidia. So there are some pictures. This is a picture of the, see, in hysterosalpingography, we put dye through the cervix, which goes to the uterus. It goes through the tubes to the peritoneal cavity. This is an abnormal picture Here, the dye has gone into the uterine cavity, and then it has passed through the tube, but the distal end of the tube is so much dilated with the fimbriel and open. This is the typical picture of tobacco pouch appearance. Tube is enlarged in distended ostium, remitting with recognizable inverted fimbriel. You can just see here. So this is a picture of tobacco pouch appearance on hysterosalpingography. Now cotton wool appearance. Here you can find focal irregularities in areas of calcification within the tube. This is cotton wool plug appearance. The tuft appearance. Here again, there will be ulceration of the mucosa of the fallopian tube. So irregular contour of the fallopian tube. Sometimes there will be diverticular. Right? So that is known as the, this is the picture of hydrosalpingo fluid collected in the tube. This is the uterus. This is the cannula, HSG cannula or Leech-Wilkinson's cannula, which is put into the cervix. This is the uterus, which is angulated actually, so it is appearing small. And these are the two tubes. You can see it is dilated in one portion with hydrosalpinx, and there is some ulcerations here, giving the tuft appearance of the fallopian tube. This is pipe stem appearance or rigid pipe-like. You can see the tubes, which are pipe-like and rigid. Okay. In this HSG, you can see there is some filling defect. The dye is not reaching. This is because of adhesion in the endometrial cavity. There could be even more adhesions, okay, leading to assurements. Now, diagnostic uterine curettage is usually done when we are working up of a case of menorrhagia, not responding to hormones. When we are working up for women with infertility, where other things have been ruled out and no cause of infertility has been found, in those cases we do diagnostic uterine curettage. That is, we take the endometrial tissue, endometrial biopsy. It is usually done in the weeks preceding menses. In that phase, the tubercle bacilli are also present in the upper layers. Okay, so in this cases, we take the endometrial tissue and make two portions of the material, send one part in formalin for histopathological examination. We will send that part for to histopathology. Another part we will store in normal saline. We can send it here only for acid phase bacilli microscopy. By Zn staining of the smear is made and acid phase bacilli is looked for. We can also go for culture in Royal Sturge Jensen medium or Bechtek. Royal Sturge Jensen will give a result after 3 weeks, and Bechtek in 1 to 2 weeks we get a result of the culture being positive or not. This is a newer, it has already been few years. In this, what happens is that the carbon dioxide that it releases helps us to diagnose. Carbon dioxide that the mycobacteria releases in the lipid medium helps us to diagnose whether the bacteria is growing or not. Now, nucleic acid amplification tests are used, you know, already for diagnosing, like CBNET, the GeneXpert, and all these techniques are used to diagnose tuberculosis. It is not only from the endometrial tissue that we take. Any kind of tissue that we are, if we find a lymph node, we can sample the lymph node. If we want to test any other lesion in the cervix or the vagina, if we want to sample that, we can take those lesions also. And one part we can send for histopathological examination, the rest we can send for acid phase bacilli, you know, for microscopy, or we can send for culture, we can send for nucleic acid amplification techniques of nucleic acid inoculation. This is not usually done. What we do is that we send for HP, we send for microscopy, and NET for the patients, for our patients. So in place of diagnostic uterine curettage, some patients may refuse a DNC for this, and some patients are unmarried young females with menorrhagia. With a history of tuberculosis, strongly predictive. In those cases, what we can do is that in place of taking the endometrial biopsy, we can ask the patient to collect the first menstrual blood. And that blood can be again subjected to microscopy, PCR as I told, the nucleic acid amplification, the culture and histology. And biopsy from appropriate sites also can be taken and subjected to the same. Now, sputum and urine may also be taken for microscopy and culture. All patients where we are suspecting tuberculosis in rounds, we ask for ESR, we ask for MOTO, we ask for chest X-ray, we ask for sputum for acid phase bacilli routinely. Now, nucleic acid amplification techniques with PCR, this method can diagnose. When we do nucleic acid amplification, we can detect fewer than 10 organisms in clinical specimen compared to 10,000 required for smear positivity. Now, AFPA microscopy examination will require 10,000 organisms to be present, in comparison to just 10 organisms that we see. But the main thing is that it will also detect sometimes the dead bacteria. Okay. Now on hysteroscopy, what will be the findings? See, the same picture I have placed here. This is a case of again extra menstrual. There is adhesions between the anterior posterior walls. This is again another case where there are adhesions between the anterior posterior wall. The ostia, these are the two ostia. Okay, that is the where the fallopian tubes open into the endometrial cavity. This is the endometrial cavity which is visualized. Here we can see the anterior posterior wall adhesions. So there could be caseous material coming out of the ostia sometimes. Okay, there could be caseation, tubercles, endometrial calcification, scanty endometrium, intrauterine adhesion, so irregular cavity. These are the findings. The ostia sometimes because of adhesions, you know, the ostia is in this case, the ostia may not be at all visualized. So these are the findings on hysteroscopy. These investigations are done only when we are working up for infertility and then we diagnose a tuberculosis. If in a confirmed case, we will not go for hysteroscopy. First, we will treat the patient with anti-tuberculosis and then we, if required, we will do it. Now, on laparoscopy, what happens is that the uterus sometimes becomes blue. You must have heard of the chromoperturbation test. This is a test to diagnose tubal patency, whether the tubes are patent or not. The dye is passed through the CE. You already know hysteroselfingography is also done to know whether the tubes are patent or not. Simultaneously, we get an information about the endometrial cavity also. We put dye into the uterus. Then this dye passes through the uterus, to the fallopian tubes, to the peritoneal cavity. And we take extra films. And with that, we get to know whether the tubes are patent or not. This is HSG. When we are doing laparoscopically, we put a camera through the umbilicus. Okay, through the umbilical cord, we see the exterior of the uterus. We see the fallopian tubes, how it looks, the normal anatomy of the organs. Then another assistant through the vagina will put the HSG cannula or Foley's catheter, whatever, so through the cervix and put dye into the uterus. And laparoscopically, it is seen whether the dye has entered the peritoneal cavity or not. And we can see from which tube we have to simultaneously see both the tubes or one by one whether dye has come out through both the tubes or not. If it has come, it means that both the tubes are patent. So laparoscopy is another way of diagnosing the tubal patency by chromoperturbation test. So during chromoperturbation, you can sometimes see the uterus itself has become blue. It could be because of, as already told, extravasation of the dye into I already told in HSG finding also, there could be vascular lymphatic extravasation of the dye. So within the vessel, this is another picture of miliary tuberculosis. The tuberculosis, this is the uterus, okay? This is the uterus, and in the uterus, you can see this tubercles present. So then this uterus will become blue in color after the dye is pushed. After the dye is pushed in the uterus, we look for the fallopian ends to see whether the dye has poured into the pelvic cavity or not. But then sometimes the uterus itself can become blue. The tubes may appear red, swollen, edematous. The tiny tubercles may be present, as already shown here. Tubercles may be present on the surface of the uterus. There could be hydroselfings, pyoselfings, tobacco pouch appearance, some tear mass could be present. Straw colored thick jelly like exudate could be present in the pouch or droplets, that is behind the uterus. And accordingly, we may have to take biopsies from the peritoneal tubercles for histology, and aspiration of the field for culture may be taken during laparoscopy. The differential diagnosis may be pyogenic tubercular etiomas, pelvic endometriosis. It could be adherent ovarian cysts, disturbed ectopic pregnancy. So in all these cases, these are the differential diagnosis. One thing, as it's written, chronic disturbed ectopic pregnancy. Sometimes when there is a etiomas, we may think that it could be pregnancy also. So we have to do one urine pregnancy test when the menstrual history is not proper in all our patients when we are suspecting tuberculosis. Because not only it comes as a differential for tuberculosis, but also if the patient is simultaneously pregnant, our investigation modality will change. We will not go for a chest x-ray without an abdominal shield in a woman where we are suspecting could be a case of tuberculosis. So, urine pregnancy test has to be done simultaneously. What complications can develop? A patient having female genital tuberculosis has high incidence of subsequent subfertility or infertility. There is high incidence of ectopic pregnancy because of the tubes being affected, because of the endometrial cavity being affected. ectopic pregnancies are common, subfertility is common, recurrent pregnancy loss is common, there could be chronic pelvic pain also. So how are we going to manage cases of tuberculosis? General care with diet. Proper diet has to be given, correction of simultaneously present anemia has to be done. Then anti-tubercular chemotherapy. Four drugs are given in the initial phase, and in the continuation phase again, two drugs are given. So the drugs used in the first phase is HRZD, isoniazide, rifampicin, pyrazinamide, and ethambutol, HRZE. These are the four drugs which are given in for 2 months. That is two HRZD and four HR, that is isoniazide and rifampicin only for the next 4 months in the continuation phase. So 6 months of anti-tubercular chemotherapy has to be given. So those who are new cases, they will get 2 months of HRZD and 4 months of HRE, and previously treated patients will get simultaneously streptomycin also. After a year of treatment, diagnostic endometrial curettage is to be done. It is preferable to confirm cure of the disease. If the histopathological or the bacteriological examination remains positive, the treatment may have to be continued. If it is negative, we can examine the endometrium at 6 months interval. A patient may be considered cured if at least two reports, including histological and bacteriological examination, becomes negative. If two reports are negative, we may consider the patient to be cured. Majority, about 90 to 95% of the patients would respond well to chemotherapy. Now the chemotherapy is given according to the dosage, the number of tablets. It comes in fixed dose combination, and they are given, the number of tablets is given according to the weight of the patient. There are some reserve line or second line drugs in the treatment. Thiacetazone, ethionamide, cyclosporin, kanamycin, capreomycin, and all these drugs are given according to the weight, less than 50 and more than 50 kgs. So newer drugs in the treatment of drug-resistant TB, it could be the newer drugs which are used are fluoroquinolone, like ciprofloxacin, ufloxacin, clofazimine, amoxiclav, then other macrolides like azithromycin, clarithromycin, roxithromycin and all. Now surgical management, see, the management is always just general care and anti-tubercular chemotherapy. Surgery is not to be done in a case of tuberculosis. Surgery could lead to flaring up of the condition, the spread of the disease. However, sometimes surgery may be required. Tubal reconstruction surgery is contraindicated. The tubes are, there are so many changes in the fallopian tubes, as you have already seen, because of tuberculosis. But tubal reconstructive surgery is contraindicated because of irreparable damage of the tube. The cilia are already destroyed. So in those cases, you should not go for a tubal reconstruction surgery. It can lead to reactivation or dissemination. Those with infertility must be treated with medical treatment, that is the anti-tubercular chemotherapy. And if it does not help, if the tubes are permanently destroyed, the patient may have to go for artificial reproductive techniques like IVF, in vitro fertilization, and embryo transfer for infertility. Surgical management, however, may be required if there is persistent or recurrent disease with pelvic mass, if there is a TO mass, if there is a non-healing, if there is pyosulfinase which is not decreasing, if there is pain abdomen, pelvic pain or abdomen bleeding despite adequate treatment, if the lesion is not healing or the symptoms are not coming, then we may have to consider for surgical management. If there is a persistent non-healing fistula, then surgical management is required. If there is multi-drug resistant disease not treated with all the drugs that you have given, or if there is a concomitant neoplasia and other diseases simultaneously of the genital tract, we may consider surgical management. However, in all these cases, chemotherapy should precede the surgery by 1 to 2 weeks. So surgical management is first and not the main treatment. The main treatment for tuberculosis is anti-tubercular chemotherapy given for 2 months of HRZD followed by 4 months of isoniazid and rifampicin. These drugs are also given when a pregnancy with tuberculosis is also associated with the same regimen of drugs. Thank you. Any questions? The entire presentation, almost everything is there in Datta Gaini. You can go through the topic from Datta Gaini whenever you get time. Earliest, you will remember more. And just this is a very important topic because you may get even long questions on genital tuberculosis and gynae. Very, very important. And now because the incidence of tuberculosis in our country is so high, you might be getting tuberculosis in medicine also. You have got tuberculosis drugs for tuberculosis in pharmacology also. So it is not very different. The management part, the anti-tubercular drugs and all is the same as in other subjects also. So you can go thoroughly about the drugs from those subjects, but from gynae, mainly need to know how it affects the genital tract organ, what are the symptoms and how we manage such cases. The investigations, mainly HSG findings may be asked in your exam. What are the findings? You may get an extra plate showing those features of tobacco pouch appearance and all. Okay. So this terminology you may have to remember, like tobacco pouch appearance, where it's found. Even in your postgraduate entrance examination, questions may come up that way. So tobacco pouch appearance is found in tuberculosis, endometriosis, options should be given. So you should know that this is typical of genital tuberculosis. Okay? Any questions? No questions? Okay, thank you.